Hello everyone, welcome to the first part of genomics data analysis module. In this module, we're going to learn how computational methods are applied to study gene expression. Our focus will be on microarrays data. So the main objective of today's lecture is to give you an overview of analysis pipeline, which we will follow in coming sessions, and to demonstrate how to locate and retrieve public data sets, mainly from repositories such as ArrayExpress and NCBI GEO. So, before we go into microarrays, let's take a step back and talk about gene expression itself. Gene expression is the process by which the information in DNA is used to produce a functional product, usually a protein and RNA molecules. When we say gene is expressed, we mean the cell is actively transcribing that gene into RNA and translating it into protein. So, expression is essentially the cell deciding which instructions in the genome are used at a given time. Like, every cell in our body contains the same DNA, but not all genes are expressed in every cell. That's why a liver cell is different from a neuron cell. So the DNA sequence is the same, but the expression pattern is different from cell to cell. That's why liver cells express genes for metabolism and detoxification, while neuron cells express genes for neurotransmitters and communication. This selective expression, some genes on, others off, is what give each cell type its identity and function. Gene expression is tightly regulated, a stepwise mechanism. When this regulation is disturbed, it can lead to pathological states. In cancer, for example, a tumor cell activates their genes, oncogenes that drive uncontrolled cell proliferation and silence those genes, tumor suppressor genes that restrict cell growth. So this imbalance in gene expression drives uncontrolled cell growth, that is the hallmark of cancer. So by comparing gene expression patterns between say cancer tissues and healthy tissues, help us identify which genes are upregulated or downregulated and which pathways may be driving disease and cure it. So studying these expressional changes not only allow us to understand disease mechanism but also help us to identify potential therapeutic targets for each. So simply by measuring gene expression, we can answer some questions like which genes are turned on and off in a particular condition, how does gene expression differ between healthy and diseased tissues, and how does treatment with a drug change gene activity. Now, there are many methods available to study gene expression, include quantitative PCR, Northern blotting, in situ hybridization, and more. Each method has its own principle and application, but when it comes to large-scale analysis of gene activity, two main approaches dominate: microarray and RNA sequencing. Microarray use pre-designed probes to measure the expression levels of thousands of genes simultaneously. RNA sequencing, on other hand, is a next-generation sequencing method that provides a more complete and unbiased picture of gene expression by directly sequencing RNA molecules. On the other hand, microarrays is the earlier technique but still remains highly relevant due to the abundance of publicly available data sets. This makes them an ideal starting point for learning computational genomics and building confidence in large-scale data analysis. So that's why in this module we focus on microarrays data. The principle of microarray technology is based on DNA-DNA hybridization, which means that DNA fragment will bind specifically to another fragment with a complementary sequence. So, a microarray is a glass slide or a silicon chip that contains thousands of fixed DNA probes. Each probe is a short DNA sequence designed to represent a specific gene. These probes are immobilized at precise locations, so every spot corresponds to one gene. mRNA from samples is reverse transcribed into complementary DNA or antisense RNA. These cDNA molecules are then labeled with fluorescent dyes, and the labeled fragments are then hybridized with their complementary probes on the microarray chip. After hybridization, the slide is washed to remove unbound fragments, leaving only the bound sequences. So, the result is a slide with different fluorescent intensities at each spot. These intensities reflect the expression levels of genes in the sample. So, by comparing the fluorescent signals, we can determine which genes are expressed in one sample or expressed in both samples or differentially expressed between the samples. And the next step is converting the scanned images of microarray into quantifiable values and annotating each with the gene IDs, sample names, and other useful information. The output of this process is a large matrix of raw data, where rows correspond to genes, columns correspond to samples, values represent expression levels. So in this way, microarrays allow to measure the expression levels of thousands of genes simultaneously. And this large matrix of raw data we will use for further downstream analysis. The file format of the raw data depends on the platform. For example, Affymetrix Array produce .cl files and are the most widely used platform, with most public dataset originating from them. Agilent Arrays generate .txt files, and other platforms may have their own formats. There are two main designs for microarrays experiments, one color and two color microarrays. In one color design, each sample is hybridized to a separate array, and the fluorescent intensity provides an absolute expression value for each sample. In two color design, two samples are labeled with different dyes, typically cyanine 3 for a control and cyanine 5 for the test cell, and they hybridize together on the same chip. So the readout is the ratio of cyanine 5 and cyanine 3 signals, which represent the expression in the test sample relative to the control. So both approaches are widely used, and while the design differ, the downstream analysis pipeline is quite similar for both of the designs. So the workflow we will follow in this module have several steps, and each step builds on the one before it. We begin with data retrieval. We use publicly available data sets. This means that we download raw data set from public databases such as NCBIGO or ArrayExpress. So the starting with raw data is important because it allows us to perform a fully reproducible analysis from the ground up. Once we have the raw data, the next step is the pre-processing. This involves mainly two tasks. First is the quality control step, where we check the quality of the arrays and the outlier samples. Second is the normalization of the data, where we reduce the technical variation across arrays while preserving their biological differences. Together, these steps make sure that the data is reliable and comparable for further analysis. After pre-processing comes differential expression analysis step. At this stage, we compare gene expression between different groups, for example, disease versus control, to identify the genes that are significantly upregulated or downregulated in different conditions. Like, say, which genes are highly expressed in cancer comparative to the normal tissues or normal samples. Like, significant p-value don't define the biological relevance or biological interpretation for that particular genes. So we need some biological interpretation and insight for our genes. So in the next step, we perform a functional enrichment analysis using different methods like gene ontology and KEK pathway analysis. This helps us interpret the biological meaning of that particular genes. Following annotation, we explore the data further through clustering and visualization techniques. This involves looking at the relationship between the samples and the genes. In the last step, we use machine learning algorithms such as random forest, support vector machine, and artificial neural network to build predictive models. Now that we know our first step is data retrieval from public database, let's start with ArrayExpress. To do so, open your web browser and do a simple search ArrayExpress BioStudy. Click on this link that takes you to the Array Express homepage within the BioStudies database. Array Express is basically a public archive hosted at EMBL EBI, European Bioinformatics Institute. It was originally designed to store microarray experiments, but over time it expanded to include many other functional genomics data sets such as RNA sequencing, methylation array, and proteomic profiling by arrays. So, since 2022, Array Express has been fully integrated into BioStudies database. When you open the Array Express website, you will see this simple search bar at the top. Here you can type in the name of a disease, a tissue type, or an experimental keyword. For example, if we type breast cancer microarray, we will get a list of data sets related to that condition. On this result page, each of these entries corresponds to a study, and each study usually contains information like the number of sample and the platform used, for example Affymetrix or Agilent, and links to download the data sets. And on the left hand side, you will also find some filters. These filters allow you to narrow down your results by study type, experimental design, organism, and publication years, and more. So we are specifically interested in human microarray dataset. Like if I select the study type as human one color microarray and human two color microarray. So the result are for the all the microarray datasets of human samples. Once you click on a dataset and let's select this one, this will take you to the study page. Here you can find the information related to this data set. First is the title of that study. Next, you will have this session ID. This is the unique identifier for each of the data set. Next, we have study type, organism, and description about the data set and experimental design. Next, we have detailed sample information table. Here you can find the detailed information of individual sample. For example, individual factor, disease type, age of the individual, or other related information. Next, if you scroll down, you will see download options. You can download the raw data files. This asterisk sign means the data file are available to download. So, for this particular data set, raw data files are available to download, but we don't have access to download process data file. You can also find the download links on the top right corner. Here you will have the link to download all the data files. So for our analysis, if we need these raw data files as well as this strf file, this is the sample and data relationship format file. This file contains the same sample information detail which I showed you in this table. So we need this information and raw data files to work. So we need this file during data analysis. And here this process file is the already normalized file. If you check the study protocol, you will find the information how they normalize their data. So if you don't want to work with raw data, you can use process data. Especially we use process data when we work with machine learning. We don't want to perform any pre-processing steps. But for the sake of this module, we will work with raw data. Okay, another important thing when you are searching for the data set, it is very important to focus on the type of the study. Like we are specifically looking for the data set that compare two clear conditions, disease versus normal, or a cancer versus healthy control, or any other disease type you are interested in to work with. But avoid to select the subdivision of that disease. Like for a cancer, if I say breast cancer, so don't select the subtypes of breast cancer. So it should be breast cancer versus normal tissue or a blood sample or any other source of that particular data set. But the condition should be a disease versus normal, not the subtypes of disease. This is important because later in our workflow, we will use the same data set for machine learning for the binary classification tasks. We will not perform a multiple classification. So for that purpose, we need this type of a data. Also try to pick data set that have more than 30 samples, because a larger sample size improves the statistical reliability and gives us more robust result when training predictive models. So to summarize, for our analysis, we need raw data files and HDRF file. You can directly download these files from the given links and focus on disease versus normal studies with sufficient sample size.